Tools are always a part of any repair experience. When you have a repair, you always have your part that you need to install or fix or change out, but whether or not that repair goes well or goes poorly really comes down to the tools and the equipment that you have on hand. iFixit's been making our own tools for more than 10 years, and we started making tools when we saw that the tools you could buy at the hardware store weren't adequate for fixing cell phones, laptops, and other electronics. The tool development process often starts with the teardown. Having an in-house teardown team is really convenient because we can go and have that research done the moment the device is released.
When they're doing a product teardown, they're taking something apart for the first time. No one else in the world, other than the product engineers who built it, have seen inside this thing. And actually, back when I was doing that job, back when I was on the teardown team, I identified quite a few repair problems that we didn't have tools to solve, that no one did, really. I was on a teardown for the Apple Watch, the first Apple Watch, and we found the smallest tri-point screws that I had ever seen, and none of the bits in my Pro Tech would fit it. And so at the teardown in Australia, I luckily had some jeweler's files and was able to sharpen one of our tri-point bits down small enough to get it out and keep going. In fact, I remember that year there was a competing team also live posting their teardown, and they got stuck at the screws and couldn't get past them. And so after we completed the teardown, I talked to Brett, who was then running the product engineering team, and I told him, hey, we're going to need some smaller tri-point screws. And I think within a matter of weeks, we had those for sale long before anyone had actually broken and needed to fix their Apple Watches.
When we first took apart the 2012 iMacs with the super thin bezels, we found the official foam tape inside had a special kind of pizza wheel used for cutting it open. And this product was only available through Apple and was very expensive. And so we immediately realized we can reverse engineer this product. Within a week of the teardown, we were producing our own version of the tool in-house. That way people could start fixing their devices right away.
So in deciding what tools to make, we look at, again, always back to our mission of helping the most people fix the most things. And so we try to focus our efforts on the most impactful tools that we can. Starting around 8 to 10 years ago, electronic devices kind of transitioned from being held together with screws and clips to being held together with lots of layers of adhesive. And the way to get through adhesive is usually heat and slow, gentle prying. We saw a really big problem that our old solution of supplying customers with a single suction cup to stick on their phone and pull it open, that just wasn't sufficient for the more modern smartphones that are just layers of glue and big, huge, thin panels of glass that really need a very slow, gentle, a prying action.
A single suction cup by itself can only pry on one side of a device, whereas the anti-clamp holds the bottom in place and lifts the top at the same time, without you having to apply constant force to it.
And so one of the coolest features that I call the slide nut is this little locking nut right here has two positions. Right now it's the unlocked open position. This makes it really easy to put the tool on your device, on the phone, and squeeze it down with a known pressure, you know how hard you're squeezing. And then you can slide it forward into this sort of locked position and start cranking. And as you turn the crank, the arms separate and it holds the suction cups in position right there. So now what I can do is let go of this, set it on the table, and it will continue slowly prying on my iPhone or S30, whatever we're at now. And then I can come in on the sides with a thin prying tool and work at that adhesive while the anti-clamp does the work for me.
We're always trying to make the repair experience better, and often that means totally new tools or finding solutions in places we didn't expect. For example, the iOpener actually started out as a sack of rice. Before the iOpener even existed, the only way to get inside an iPad 2 was to use a heat gun, but there were a lot of consequences with melting plastic and damaging displays. So one of our tech writers suggested using a therapeutic rice pack to help heat the glue on the side of the iPad. With some help, she actually went home and she sewed us a prototype of the iOpener that very night out of muslin and rice in a little bag. For many months, we actually sold rice-filled bags as iOpeners. However, if you overheat a bag of rice, your whole house smells like burned rice. We went through several iterations of grain-based iOpeners before we landed on our current iOpener, which is a polymer bag filled with glycerin. That heats up better, retains heat better, and transfers heat onto the iPad better as well. And it doesn't smell like burned rice.
Tools are always evolving here at iFixit. We're always looking for ways to improve our existing products. Back when I started as a tech writer, our go-to bit set was the 54-bit kit, which was pretty much a white label product in a clear plastic clamshell case. All of the bits were held in little rubber bit rows that were laid down in like a little stack inside this case. And one of our biggest improvements was replacing that with the Mako kit. It's got a magnetic case. You can actually take the top off, and there's a little sorting tray built into the top. And there are laser cut foam holes for everything. Everything is held in place really tightly. And so if you throw this case in your bag, you're not gonna end up playing 64-bit pickup at the end of the day. And that's, I think, one of our most improved and awesome products that I'm really proud of.
We redesigned the repair business toolkit to make sure that all the tools inside were appropriate for all the modern repairs that people need to undertake.
So the RBT, the repair business toolkit, is like our apex predator product. It is the top level tool offering that includes all of our other best tools. And so we recently updated it by adding the FixMat and the anti-clamp, which are our two newest awesome tools that definitely deserve to be in there.
The RBT is meant to be both a repair station and a diagnostic station, which is why we include a whole series of measurement and instrumentation tools, as well as the standard disassembly and fixing tools that you might find in the Pro Tech Toolkit.
I definitely feel like designing tools that address repair problems is a really impactful way to help people fix the world around them.
Every day I get excited to help people make the world a better place with better tools and better repairs.
I think that everybody has something broken in their life, and it's really cool when you find the right tool to fix it. And so for all of the immeasurable repair problems out there, we are working on as many solutions as we can to help people fix things around them and fix the world.